Get ready to build your own Sling game using Python and Pygame. We will take it step by step, and in a couple of hours, you'll have a fully functional and impressive Sling game to show off. Here is a sneak peek at the steps ahead of us. Installing the Pygame library, creating a black canvas and setting up the game loop, creating the food, creating the snake, moving the snake, make the snake eat the food, making the snake grow longer with each bite, checking for collisions with the edges and the snake's own tail, adding a title and a frame to the game to make it more visually appealing, keeping score, and lastly, we have to add sounds. So, are you ready to create something amazing? Let's make it happen! Let's kick off step number one by diving right into installing Pygame so we can start building our snake game. When it comes to installing Pygame, there are a couple of things to keep in mind depending on the version of Python you have installed. If you are using Python 3.11, it is important to note that the stable version of Pygame is not currently compatible with this version. Therefore, in order to use Pygame with Python 3.11, you will need to install a development version. To do this, simply open a terminal window and type pip install pygame --pre. This command will download and install the latest version of Pygame and its dependencies. The --pre flag tells pip to install a pre-release version of the package. On the other hand, if you are watching this video in the future or you are using an older version of Python and Pygame now supports it, you can simply install the stable version by typing the following command in your terminal window: pip install pygame. With the Pygame library installed, we can now verify that it is working correctly by running a simple test script. To do this, create a new folder, create a new Python file in it, and name it snake.py. Inside the file, import Pygame by typing import Pygame. Next, run the program to see if Pygame is installed correctly. If you see the message "Hello from the Pygame community," your installation is working fine and we have successfully completed step number one. That was easy, wasn't it? We are one step closer to our goal of building a fully functional snake game. Let's move on to step number two. The next step in building our snake game is to create a blank screen and set up the game loop. Before we start, it is important to understand the structure of a game. Every game consists of two parts: the part where we define our variables and game objects, such as the snake, the food, and the arena, and the game loop, which is responsible for updating the position of the game objects and checking for collisions. The game loop is like the heartbeat of the game, running repeatedly until the game is closed. In each iteration of the game loop, we will draw the game objects in their new positions and check for collisions, all happening so fast that it appears as a continuous movement. Now, let's create a blank screen and the game loop. First of all, we need to initialize Pygame, so we type pygame.init. Then we create a display surface. A display surface is like a black canvas where we can draw our game objects. We need to specify the width and the height of the display surface. I am going to use a size of 750 by 750 pixels for now. We will change that later. Let's create the display surface. Screen is equal to pygame.display.setmode parentheses and again parentheses 750, 750. This line of code creates a display surface object named screen. The setMode method takes a tuple as an argument. The first value is the width and the second value is the height of the display surface, our canvas. In simpler terms, we just created the game window, and to draw on it, we use a coordinate system similar to the one taught in high school. Each point on this window has its unique x and y values. The coordinate system used in computer graphics differs from the standard Cartesian coordinate system taught in high school. In computer graphics, the origin of the display is located at the top left corner, with 0,0 being at the top left. In contrast, the standard Cartesian coordinate system starts from the bottom left corner, with 0,0 being the origin. In this system, the x-coordinate increases as we move to the right and the y-coordinate increases as we move up. However, in the top left corner coordinate system used in computer graphics, the x-coordinate increases as we move to the right and the y-coordinate increases as we move down. This means that the point 10,10 will be located 10 units to the right and 10 units down from the origin. We will be using the top left corner coordinate system in our snake game. That's why it is important to understand the differences between these two coordinate systems. Now that we have created the screen, we need to give it a title. We do that by using the setCaption function. Pygame.display.setCaption parentheses quotes retro snake. Next, we create a clock object like this. Clock is equal to pygame.time.clock. Be careful, we need a capital C here. We need this clock object to control the frame rate of the game, how fast the game will run. Don't worry about this line of code now. We will get back to it in a minute. The basic setup of the game is now complete. Let's now work on the game loop. The game loop consists of three parts. First, event handling. First, we need to check for any events that occur in the game, such as quitting the game, a key press on the keyboard, etc. This is done using the Pygame event handling system. 2. Updating positions. Next, we update the positions of all the game objects, such as the snake and foot, based on the events we detected in step 1. 3. Drawing objects. Finally, we draw all the game objects in their new positions on the screen. This step uses the Pygame graphics functions to render the objects in the display. By following these three steps, we can create a dynamic and interactive game that responds to the user inputs and updates its states accordingly. We start the game loop with a while loop like this, while true, colon. This while loop is an essential part of our snake game. It runs continuously until we close the game. At each iteration of the loop, we perform three key steps: checking for events, updating positions of the game objects, and drawing the game objects in their new positions. It is important to note that before running the game, we need to ensure that the code inside the while loop has been fully written. If we run the code at this point, the while loop will run indefinitely, since we have not defined a way to stop its execution. So in the next step, we will add the necessary code to stop the while loop. For event in pygame.event.get, colon. This line of code gets all the events that Pygame recognizes and happened since the last time the while loop ran and puts them in a list. Then we loop through the list of events and check if any of the events is the quit event. The quit event is when we click on the close button of the window. If the event is the quit event, we break out of the while loop. If event.type equals equals pygame.quit in capitals, colon, pygame.quit. And then we have to close the program completely with the command sys.exit. This command is part of the sys module, so we have to import it like this. In the first line of the code, after importing pygame, we type comma sys. That's it. Now we have defined a way to exit the game, but we need a couple more lines of code before running our game for the first time. We have to update the screen with this line of code outside of the for loop, pygame.display.update. This line of code takes all the changes we made in the game objects and draws a picture from them. Since we haven't created any game objects yet, this line just draws a black screen. Remember the clock object we created in the beginning. We need to use it now. We have to tell the clock object how fast the game should run. We do that by using the tick method. The tick method takes an integer as an argument, and that integer is the number of frames per second that we want. I am going to use 60 frames per second. Clock.tick 60. That's it. This means that the while loop and all the code inside it will run 60 times every second. If we didn't set a frame rate, the game would run as fast as the computer can handle, which could lead to inconsistencies in the game speed. By setting the frame rate, we make sure that the game runs smoothly and at the same speed for all players. Now that the game loop is complete, we can run the game for the first time. If we run the game at this point, we won't see anything, because we haven't drawn anything yet. But the important thing is that we can reliably close the game by clicking on this X icon here. Cool! But the game window is black. Let's make it green. Pygame provides several built-in colors, but we will be defining our own colors for this game. In Pygame, colors are represented as a tuple of three values, each value representing the amount of red, green, and blue in the color. Our game will have a retro look, so we will be using only two colors, green and dark green. We will create two tuples to store the values of these colors. So at the beginning of our code, we define the colors like this. Green is equal to parentheses 173, 204, 96, and dark green is equal to 43, 51, 24. Now, let's paint the game screen green. Inside the game loop, before updating the screen, we call the fill method of the screen object like this. Screen.fill parentheses green. The fill method just fills the display surface we have created, our canvas, with the color we define, in this case, green. If we run the game now, we can see the game window is now green. Beautiful! We just completed a very basic game loop, so we can remove step number 2 from our list. We have made progress. Let's now work on step number 3. We are going to create the first game object. We are going to create a food object. Before we create our game object, let's think about the game logic. To make our lives easier as game developers, we are going to use a technique very common in game development. We are going to create a grid, that is, we are going to divide the game screen in a large number of identical cells. This grid will be invisible in reality. We will just use it to help us with the positioning and the movement of the objects on the display. So, if we want to display a food object, we are going to display it inside a cell. Also, the snake object will be a list of cells, and it will move one cell each time it moves. Let's create the grid now, and we will discuss more about it later on. We are going to create a variable that will store the size of each cell. Let's call it cell size, and we will set it to 30. Now, let's create a variable for the number of cells for each row and column of the grid. I will call it number of cells. We are going to set it to 25. This means that the grid will cover an area of 750 by 750 pixels. That's exactly the resolution of our game screen. So let's remove it from here and let's replace it with this expression. Cell size times number of cells, comma, cell size times number of cells. Cool. Let's now run the game. As we can see, the game window is exactly the same as before, 750 by 750 pixels, which is 25 times 30 pixels. Let's now create the food class, which will create the food object of our game. We type class food colon, and then we create the init function, def init parentheses, self, colon. The init function is a special function in Python that is used when creating an object of a class. It is used to set up or initialize the object by defining the attributes that the object will have when it is created. This allows objects to be customized when they are created and makes it easier to create multiple objects with different attributes. Now, let's think about the attributes the object is going to have. What do we want to know about the foot? First of all, we need to know its position on the grid. The obvious way to implement this is to use x and y attributes for the position on the grid. But there is another way to do it, which will make our lives easier later on. The Vector2 class the Pygame library offers. You can think of it as a data structure that contains x and y attributes, the same attributes that we want to use for our class. That's only one of the many advantages of the Vector2 class. The class also provides a lot of useful methods that we're going to use later. For now, let's use a Vector2 variable to hold the position of the foot object. So, in our foot class, we type self.position is equal to Vector2 parentheses 5, 6. This line of code creates a Vector2 object to hold the position of the foot object. The two numbers in the parentheses 5 and 6 are the x and y coordinates of the foot. For example, the foot's x coordinate can be accessed by self.position.x and its y coordinate by self.position.y. Keep in mind that these numbers do not represent pixels but cells. This means that the foot's position is at the 6th column and the 7th row in our grid, with the counting starting from 0. But to use the Vector2 class, we have to import it. So we type from pygame.math import Vector2 at the top of our file. Now let's draw the foot object on the screen. We are going to create a new method for the foot class and we are going to name it draw. Def draw parentheses self colon. Now, before we draw something, let's talk about how Pygame draws on the screen. We have three basic concepts to learn: the display surface, the regular surface, and the rect. The display surface is the surface where we see all the game objects. It's like the blank canvas we talked about before. The display surface is created when we call the setMode function, and it's the object we use when we call the update function here. A regular surface is a surface like the display surface that we can draw on. We can have as many surfaces as we want in a game, unlike the display surface, which we can only have one per game. We are going to use surfaces to draw text on the display surface and display the foot image later on. A rect is a rectangular area. It has a position and a size. We use rects for collision detection and easy manipulation of objects and for easy drawing on a surface, as you are going to find out in a minute. Now that we know the basics of how drawing works in Pygame, let's draw our first object, the foot object. First of all, we have to create a rect to contain the foot. This rectangle will be invisible, but it will help us draw the foot on the screen. So we type footRect is equal to pygame.rect parentheses x, y, w, and h. We need to know four things to create the rect object: the x and the y coordinate of its top left corner, its width, and its height. The x is going to be self.position.x, but since we are using a grid, we have to multiply this by cell size. We do the same thing for the y, self.position.y times cell size. Now, the width is going to be cell size, and the height is also going to be cell size. Cool! Now we can draw the foot object. Let's draw it as a square for now, and later on we are going to load an image for this object. We are going to call the pygame.draw.rect method. This method requires three arguments: the surface to draw the object on, a color, and a rect. We have everything we need. The surface we're going to draw on is the display surface, named screen. The color is dark green, and the rect we want to draw is the foot rect. That's it. Our draw method is ready. Let's use it in our code. First of all, we have to create a food object. So before the game loop, we type food is equal food. Now, all we have to do is to call the draw method of the food object in the main loop. So after this line of code, we type food.draw. If we now run the game, we can see a dark green square on the screen. Beautiful! Our first game object is now visible. Great job! Now that we have successfully drawn a square to represent the food object in our game, it's time to take it to the next level by using an actual image. To load an image for the food object, we need to use the pygame.image.load function. This function takes the file path of the image as an argument and returns a surface that you can use to draw the image on the screen. I have placed the image for the food object in a folder named graphics in my game folder. The name of the image is food.png. So outside of the game loop, we type food surface is equal to pygame.image.load parentheses graphics slash food.png. This line of code returns a surface that contains our image. We need to display that surface on top of the display surface. To display the image, we will have to modify the draw method of the food class. Instead of calling the pygame.draw.rect method, we will use the plit method of the display surface to draw the image on the screen. Screen.plit. The plit method requires two arguments. The surface to draw, which is food surface, and the rect object that defines the position and the size of the image on the screen, which is the food rect. We are ready. Let's test our code. Excellent! The food object is now being displayed with an image, making the game more visually appealing. This improvement brings us one step closer to creating a complete and polished game experience. The problem with our code so far is that the food object is going to be created at the same spot every time we run the game. Let's randomize it. In the food class, let's create a new method called generateRandomPose. Instead of a fixed position, we're going to create a random one. So let's import the random module because we are going to need it. Comma random here. Now, let's create a random value for the x-coordinate of the food object. We are going to use the randint function from the random module, which generates a random number in a range. We need a number from 0 to 24, because we have 25 cells on each row of the grid. X is equal to random.randint, parentheses 0, comma, number of cells minus 1. We do the same for the y-coordinate of the food object. Y is equal to random.randint, parentheses 0, comma, number of cells minus 1. Now we have to set these values to a vector2 object to return it. Position is equal to vector2, parentheses, x, comma, y. And we have to return that position. Return position. Now, in the init function, all we have to do is to call this function when we set the position of the object. So, self.position is equal to self.generateRandomPose. Now, if we run the game multiple times, we can see that the food object is created in different cell each time. Very cool! Our food object is ready. Another step is now complete. Well done! If you made it this far, rest assured. Things are progressing more quickly from now on. We had a lot of things to learn so far. Now let's move on to step number 4. Let's create the snake. To represent the snake, we have to draw some of the cells of the screen dark green. The body of the snake is going to be just a Python list of some cells. For start, let's make the snake 3 cells long. In our code, the snake will be represented as a list of 3 cells. But we won't store the cells in the list, only their coordinates. The easiest way to do it is to use a vector2 object to store the x and y coordinates of each cell of the snake body, like this. The first item in the list is going to be the head of the snake, and the remaining ones the tail. Let's write some code to create the snake and draw it on the screen. First of all, let's create a snake class. Class snake, colon. And now we need the init function. def init self colon. As we said, the body of the snake is going to be a list of three vector2 objects. So we type self.body is equal to brackets vector2, vector2, vector2. Now we have to enter some coordinates for the snake body. Let's enter 6,9 for the head and 5,9 and 4,9 for the tail. That's it. Our representation of the snake in code is ready. Now let's draw the snake on the screen. Let's create a draw method which will be responsible for drawing the snake body. Def draw self colon. We need to draw each segment of the snake body. Our snake has three segments, three cells to be drawn, and we are going to use a for loop to draw them all. For segment in self.body colon. Now, as we did before, in the foot class, we will simply draw a square for each segment. Let's create a rectangle for each segment. Segment rect is equal to, we need the x and y coordinate, the width and the height of the rect. Segment.x times cell size, segment.y times cell size, comma cell size, comma cell size. Now we need to draw this rect on the display surface and give it a dark green color. Pygame.draw.rect parenthesis screen, that's the display surface, comma dark green, comma segment rect. That's it. Now let's create a snake object and call its draw method. So before the game loop we type snake is equal to snake. And in the game loop after drawing the foot we type snake.draw. Let's now run the game to see our snake for the first time. Beautiful, the snake is visible. Each segment of the snake's body is a square, so the snake appears like a rectangle. Let's make each segment of the snake body a rounded rectangle to be more pleasing to the eye and to be able to see the discrete segments of its body. So in the draw method of the snake class, we change the draw line here like this. We add 0,7. The 0 is that we want the rectangle to be filled with color, and the value 7 is the border radius of the rectangle. If we run the game once more, we can see our snake has rounded segments. Cool! Another step is now complete. We can move on to the next step, which is to make our snake move. Let's think about the movement of the snake. The easiest way to approach it is this. As we said, our snake is just a list of three objects. We can move the snake object by removing the last cell in the list and adding a new cell to the beginning of the list. This will allow us to simulate a movement of the snake object across the grid. Let's say we want to move the snake to the right. We remove the last cell from it and we add another one at the beginning. One cell to the right. Our snake moved one cell to the right. Let's say we want to move the snake down. We remove the last cell from it and we add another one at the beginning, one cell to the bottom. The head of the snake moved one cell downwards. Cool, huh? No fancy maths required. Just remove the last cell and add another one to the direction of the movement. Because we are using vector2 objects to represent the segments of the snake's body, we can easily calculate the coordinates of the segment we are adding. We can perform mathematical operations with vector2 objects. For example, let's take the head of the snake, which is a vector2 object with an x value of 6 and a y value of 9. We can add another vector to it. For instance, if we add the vector 1,0, the resulting vector will be 7,9, which is like moving the head to the right. If we added the vector 2 minus 1,0, the head would move to the left. In the same way, if we added a vector 2 0, minus 1, the head would move upwards. And if we added a vector 2 0, 1, the head would move downwards. Vector2 objects are making our task much easier. Now let's implement this in code. First, let's make the snake move to the right. Then we will implement user input to control its movement. We will add another attribute to the snake class. We need to know the direction in which the snake is moving, and this attribute will be a vector2 object. So we will add the following line to the snake class. Self.direction is equal to vector2. And since we want the snake to move to the right, we will set the value inside the vector2 like this. Vector2, 1, 0. Now let's create an update method where the position of the snake is going to be updated. Def update self colon. As we said before, moving the snake is just two actions. First, we're going to remove the last segment of the snake's body. Let's do it. Self.body is equal to self.body brackets colon minus 1. In Python, lists can be indexed using square brackets. The colon is used for slicing and it allows you to select a range of elements from a list. So when you use brackets colon minus 1, it means you are selecting all elements from the beginning of the list up to the second last element, which effectively removes the last element from the list. In this case, the self.body list is being reassigned to itself, but with the last element removed. So this line of code is removing the last segment of the snake's body, as stated before. Now, our snake object body list has only two elements. We need to add another one at the beginning of the list. To do this, we will use the insert method for lists, like this. Self.body.insert, 0. That's the index of the first element of the list. Now we need to add the head of the snake, but moved in the direction specified by the direction attribute. We can do this by adding the snake's head, self.body0, to the direction vector, self.direction. So self.body0 plus self.direction. This will move the snake's head in the direction specified by the direction attribute and add it to the beginning of the snake's body list. Believe it or not, two lines of code are needed to move the snake. Now let's call the update method inside the game loop. Before the drawing part of the game loop, let's type snake.update. Now let's run the game to see what happens. As you can see, the snake moves, but it moves too quickly and it disappears from the game window. Let's first address the first problem. The game loop is executed 60 times per second, so the update method of the snake object is also called 60 times per second. This causes the snake to move 60 cells to the right every second, which is why it moves so quickly. Instead of calling the update method of the snake in every execution of the game loop, we need to update it at a slower rate, for example, every 200 milliseconds. This will slow down the snake's movement and make it more visible on the screen. To achieve this, we are going to create a timer event using the PyGame library. First, let's create a custom event for our game and give it a name. Snake update is equal to pygame.userEvent. This line of code creates a variable, snake update, and assign it the value of pygame.userEvent. UserEvent is a special event type in PyGame that can be used to create custom events. In this case, it is used to create an event that will be triggered every time the snake's position needs to be updated. Now let's tell PyGame when to trigger this custom event. We want to trigger it every 200 milliseconds. To do this, we will use the setTimer function from the pygame.time module. pygame.time.setTimer parentheses snake update, 200. This function creates a timer that will trigger the snake update event every 200 milliseconds. The first argument is the event that needs to be triggered, and the second argument is the interval in milliseconds. In this way, we are ensuring that the snake is updating its position every 200 milliseconds and not 60 times per second, avoiding the problem of the snake moving too fast. Now, in the game loop, as we said before, we check for any events that happened since the last time the game loop was executed. Let's add a check for our custom event. This is very simple. If event.type equals equals snake update colon snake.update. This code checks if the event type is equal to snake update, and if it is, it calls the update method of the snake object. This ensures that the snake's position is updated only when the snake update event is triggered and not every time the game loop is executed. It is important to remove the call to the snake update method that was previously in the game loop to avoid updating the snake's position more than once per interval. With this setup, let's run the game once more to see if it works. As you can see, the snake is moving a lot slower. Perfect. Now the snake's movement is visible and the game is more playable. Of course, we can't control the snake yet, so it will disappear from the screen in a few seconds. So let's add keyboard controls to the game. In order to control the snake's movement, we need to detect when the player presses certain keys on the keyboard. To do this, we add the following code inside the game loop. If event.type equals equals pygame.keyDown, colon. This line of code checks if the event type is equal to the keyDown constant, which means the player has pressed a key. Now we need to determine which key the player pressed. We can do this by using the event.key attribute. This attribute returns a constant representing the key that was pressed. For example, to check if the player pressed the up arrow key, we can use this if statement. If event.key equals equals pygame.kup colon. This line of code checks if the event key constant is equal to the pygame.kup constant, which represents the up arrow key. If the player presses the up arrow key, we have to move the snake upwards. We can do this by updating the snake's direction attribute to move up like this. Snake.direction is equal to vector2 parenthesis 0, minus 1. When we set the snake directions to vector2 0, minus 1, we are indicating that the snake should move upwards. The vector2 class represents a 2D vector with x and y components. In this case, we are setting the x component to 0 and the y component to minus 1. The origin of the game window is located at the top left corner, which means that y coordinates increase as we move downwards. So in order to move upwards, we need to decrease the y coordinate. That's why we set the y component of the direction vector to minus 1, which tells the snake to move upwards on the y axis. Similarly, we detect if the user has pressed any of the other keys on the keyboard and we change the direction of the snake accordingly. If event.key equals equals pygame.kDown, the user has pressed the down key. Snake.direction is equal to vector2 0,1. If event.key equals equals pygame.kLeft colon, snake direction is equal to vector2 minus 1,0. And if event.key is equal equal pygame.kRight colon, snake direction is equal to vector2 1,0. Great! We can now control the movement of our snake by using the arrow keys. However, there is an issue with our current code. If the snake is moving to the right and the player presses the left arrow key, the snake will immediately change direction and start moving to the left. To prevent this from happening, we need to add a check to ensure that the snake cannot move in the opposite direction of its current movement. For example, if the snake is currently moving to the right, we should not allow the player to press the left arrow key and change the snake's direction. In code, we alter the if statements like this. If event.key equals equals pygame.kup and snake direction is not equal to vector2 0,1, colon. We will only allow the snake to change its direction upwards only if it is not moving downwards. We do the same for all the other three if statements. If event.key equals equals pygame.kDown and snake direction is not equal to vector2 0,-1, and if event.key equals equals pygame.kLeft and snake direction is not equal to vector2 1,0, and lastly, if event.key equals equals pygame.kRight and snake direction is not equal to vector2 -1,0. Great work! We have successfully implemented the ability for the player to control the movement of the snake. Now, if we run the game again, we can see that the game moves smoothly and responds to the player's input as desired. This is a significant milestone in the development of our game. Keep up the good work, as we are making steady progress and the remaining tasks will be relatively straightforward to implement. Before moving on to the next step, let's take a moment to organize our code for better management and maintainability. To improve code organization and make it easier to manage in the future, we will create a game class to hold the snake and the food objects, as well as various methods. The game class will serve as a container for all the elements of our game, such as the snake, the food, and the game state. It will also hold methods that manage the game's logic, such as updating the snake's position, checking for collisions, etc. By centralizing all the game's functionality within this class, it will be easier to understand, maintain, and expand upon in the future. Additionally, it will also improve code readability and reduce the risk of bugs by keeping related code together in one place. Overall, creating a game class will greatly improve the organization and structure of our code base, making it easier to work with in the future. So let's create a new game class. Class game colon. This class will create and hold the snake object and the food object. So in the init method, let's create a snake and a food object. Def init self colon. Self.snake is equal to snake and self.food is equal to food. The game class will of course have a draw method in which it will draw all the game objects by calling the draw method of each of the two objects it holds. So we type def draw parenthesis self colon self.food.draw and self.snake.draw. We also need an update method that is going to update the positions of the game objects and it will check for collisions. So we type def update parenthesis self colon. So far we only move the snake, so we only type self.snake.update. The first version of our game class is ready. Let's create a game object and call its methods. We first delete the food and snake objects here. We don't need them anymore. The game class will create its own food and snake objects. We now create a game class object. Game is equal to game. Now, inside the game loop, we have to make some modifications to the code. Here, instead of snake.update, we need to call the update method of our game class. So we type game.update. Also here, where we check for user input, we need to access the snake object of the game class. So we type game dot here and here. We do the same for all the other if statements. It will take me some time to change them all. Now, the last thing we have to do is to remove these two lines of code where we draw the game objects and just call the draw method of the game class, game dot draw. That's it. If we now run the game once more, we can see it is working like before, but our code is more readable and easier to work with, as you are going to find out later. Let's move on to the next step of the game development, which is to make the snake eat the food. Let's think about this for a moment. When does the snake eat the food? When its head is in the same cell with the food. So the first thing we have to do is to check if the snake's head cell and the food cell are the same for every update of the game. If that happens, the snake will eat the food and we have to create another food object in another random location. Let's do this. In the game class, let's add another method. Def check collision with food self colon. Now we have to check if the head of the snake is at the same cell with the food. If self.snake.body brackets 0, that's the snake's head, equals self.food.position colon. Let's print something to see if this works. Print eating food. Now we have to call this function in the update method of the game class, self.checkCollisionWithFood. Let's run the game. As you can see, at the console we can see the message eating food each time we collide with the food. Beautiful! Now we have to change the position of the food object each time it collides with the snake. We can call the generateRandomPosition of the food object to achieve that. We can delete the print statement, we don't need it anymore, and add the following line. self.food.position is equal to self.food.generateRandomPosition. Let's run the code once more. As you can see, now when we eat the food, its position on the screen changes to a random location. But there is a problem. There is a small probability that the new cell position is on top of the snake. We can't allow this to happen. So we have to modify the generateRandomPose method of the food class to check if the new position exists in a list of cells. If this is true, it has to generate a new position for the food object. This list of cells is going to be the snake body list. Let's name it snake body and pass it in as an argument to the method. Now we have to add the following to the method: while position in snake body colon, which means that the random position we generated is one of the segments of the snake body. Then we have to create another random position. We copy this block of code in the while loop like this. But this is not a good programming practice. We have duplicate code here. Instead, we are going to create a method for this block of code. Let's call it def generate random cell, parenthesis self, colon. And now x is equal to random.randint, parenthesis 0, number of cells minus 1, and y is equal to random.randint, parenthesis 0, number of cells minus 1, and return vector 2, parenthesis x, y. This method returns a random cell position. Now we modify the generate random pose method like this: position is equal to self.generateRandomCell, and while position in snake body colon, position is equal to self.generateRandomCell, and return position. The method is now clear and concise. However, since we modified the method arguments, we need to update the method call in all the location where it is used. In particular, when we first create the food object, we need to pass the snake body as an argument to the init method here, and pass it in the call of the generateRandomPose method here. In the game class, we need to update the creation of the food object to include the snake's body list as an argument. Self.food is equal to food parenthesis self.snake.body. In the checkCollisionWithFood method, when we call the method to update the food object's position, we also need to pass in the snake's body list as an argument. By updating the food creation and placement method to take into account the snake's body, we can ensure that the food will never spawn on top of the snake. Now, when we test the game again, we can see that it is functioning as intended and the food is placed in a valid location. Another step is now complete. Well done! Now that the snake can successfully locate and consume the food, let's move on to the next step. The snake's growth is an important aspect of the game, and we need to code the behavior that allows the snake to grow by one segment or cell each time it eats food. Before we implement the snake's growth behavior, let's consider how it should work. When the snake eats food, we want it to increase in size by adding an additional segment to its body. It is important to note that this segment should be added to the beginning of the snake's body, as this creates a more natural visual effect. Additionally, when the snake grows, we should not move it at the same time, as this can create an unnatural jumpy appearance. In summary, when the snake eats food, we will add a new segment to the beginning of its body and not move it for that call of the update method. So the update method of the snake class must know if it has to add a segment to the snake or to move the snake. For this, let's create a new attribute to the snake class and call it addSegment and set it to false. Now in the update method, we check the value of this attribute. If self.addSegment equals true, colon, we have to add another segment to the snake. Else, colon, we move the snake, so we just indent the code which is responsible for moving the snake. Now let's write code to add a segment to the snake body. Adding a segment to the snake's body is very easy. We have to insert a new element to the body list, so we are going to use the insert method of the list, self.body.insert. we need to enter a new element at the beginning, so the first argument is 0. Now we need to add another element next to the head of the snake. So to find the position of the next element, we first get the position of the head of the snake, which is self.body bracket 0. And now we have to add the direction of the movement of the snake like this, plus self.direction. That's all we have to do. Now that the snake has increased the size, we have to set the add segment attribute to false. Now, if we look closely at this method, we can see that we have written the same line of code twice. It is a good idea to remove any duplicate code. So let's rewrite this block of code to avoid this. We're going to move this line of code outside of the if statement and remove it from here. That's it, no more duplicate code. We can move on. At the checkCollisionWithFood method of the game class, we have to write this line of code. self.snake.addSegment equals true to notify the snake object that it needs to grow in size. Now we are ready to test our code. As you can see, the snake moves as before, and every time it collides with a food object, it grows in size by one segment. One more step of our game is now complete. Now we have to check if our snake hits the end of the game window. Now this is very easy. All we have to do is to check if the position of the head of the snake is out of the grid at the x and y axis. Let's create another method for this check in the game class. Def check collision with edges colon. If self.snakebody.0, that's the head of the snake, a vector2 object. First, let's check if the snake is outside of the grid at the x axis. So we need to access the x attribute of the head of the snake. .x equals equals number of cells, or self.snake.body bracket 0.x equals equals minus 1. Here, if the x position of the head of the snake is equal to the number of cells, meaning it has gone past the right edge of the grid, or equal to minus 1, meaning it has gone past the left edge of the grid, if either of these conditions are true, it means the snake has hit the edge of the grid and a collision has occurred, so we have to end the game. Let's call a gameOver method. self.gameOver. We haven't created this method yet. We will do this in a minute. Before that, let's check if the snake moved outside of the game window from the top or the bottom of the screen. If self.snake.body bracket 0.y equals equals number of cells, or self.snake.body brackets 0.y equals equals minus 1 colon. self.gameOver. Now let's call this method in the update method of the game class like this: self.checkCollisionWithEdges. It is now time to create the gameOver method. Def gameOver colon. At first, let's just print a message to see if the collision with the edges of the game window works. Print game over. Let's now run the game to see if it works. Okay, the game works, and when we move outside of the game window, a game over message is printed at the console. Cool, our collisions work. Now, inside the game over method, we add the behavior we want when the game ends. I'll keep it very simple in this video, but you can add any behavior you want in your version of the game. When the game is over, I will just return the snake to its starting position, move the food object to a new position, and pause the game until the player presses any key on the keyboard. First of all, let's remove this print statement and let's move the snake to its original position. Let's create a reset method to the snake object to be responsible for that. Let's call this method and implement it at once. self.snake.reset. Now let's implement this reset method in the snake class. Def reset parenthesis self colon. self.body is equal to brackets vector 2 parenthesis 6,9 comma vector 2 parenthesis 5,9 comma vector 2 parenthesis 4,9. And self.direction is equal to vector 2 1,0. We just recreate the original body list and direction attributes. The new method is ready. Now we have to move the food object to a new position. Again, we are going to call the generateRandomPose method of the food object. self.food.generateRandomPause(self.snake.body). Now we have to pause the game until the player presses any key on the keyboard. For this, we're going to need to add another attribute to the game class. Let's call this attribute state. self.state equals. The state attribute can only have two possible values. Let's call them running if the game runs and stopped if the game is stopped. Let's add a state running. Now, when the game ends, we have to change the game state to stopped. So we type self.state equals stopped. Now we have to make the game stop when the state is stopped. We can do that easily inside the update method of the game class. We need to execute all this stuff only when the game is running. So we add an if statement. If self.state equals equals running colon. And now we enter all these calls inside the if statement like this. Let's test the game. The game runs, and when we hit the end of the game window, the game resets and stops running. The game won't restart because we haven't yet defined how the game will restart. That's what we are going to do now. We need to restart the game when the user has pressed any key on the keyboard. The solution to this is very easy. In the game loop, we already check if some keys are pressed. This if statement checks if any key is pressed, and with the other if statements below, we check if some specific keys are pressed. So inside the first if statement, we have to type if game.state equals equals stopped colon game.state equals running. The last two lines of code define the restart behavior for the game. The if statement checks if the current game state is stopped. If it is, the state of the game is changed to running. This means that when the game is stopped, if any key is pressed, the state of the game will change to running, and the game will restart. Let's test it. As you can see, when I move the snake outside of the game window, the game ends, and it waits for a key press. When I press any key on the keyboard, the game restarts. Very, very cool. The next condition we need to implement is checking for a collision between the snake's head and its tail. If the snake's head hits its tail, the game should end. To check for this collision, we need to check if the position of the head is equal to the position of any of the segments in the body. To implement this, we can add another method in the game class called checkCollisionWithTail. Let's write code for it. Def checkCollisionWithTail parenthesis self colon headless body is equal to self.snake.body brackets 1 colon. And then if self.snake.body bracket 0 in headless body colon self.game over. The method checkCollisionWithTail first creates a new list called headless body, which contains all the segments of the snake's body except the head. This is because we don't want to check if the head is colliding with itself. Next, we use an if statement to check if the position of the head is in the headless body list. If it is, it means that the head has collided with the tail and the game is over. We call the game over method to end the game. Of course, we also have to call this method in the update method of the game class. self.checkCollisionWithTail. Let's test the game again to see if the collision with the tail works as expected. As you can see, we have to eat a few food objects to increase the snake size. When the snake is big enough and when the snake's head collides with its tail, the game ends and waits for a key press to restart. With this, we have implemented all the necessary behavior for our snake game. Congratulations on making it this far and creating a working game. Now, let's enhance the appearance of our snake game. We will add a 75-pixel border around the game window and create a rectangle with a dark green border to contain the play area to look like this. To add the border, we will define an offset value named offset with a value of 75 pixels. This offset value will determine the width of the border. Let's adjust the size of the game window to include the frame of 75 pixels on each side. In this line of code, we create the game window. The first two arguments in this call are the width and the height of the game window. We need to increase that by 2 times offset pixels. So we change this line of code like this. 2 times offset plus cell size times number of cells and 2 times offset plus cell size times number of cells. We will also create a dark green rectangle in the game loop with no fill and a stroke of 5 pixels to contain the play area. This will create a visually appealing frame around the game window and help distinguish it from the rest of the screen. To draw the dark green rectangle, we will use the pygame.draw.rect function, which takes 4 arguments: the surface to draw on, the color of the rectangle, the position of the rectangle, and the border size of the rectangle. So we type pygame.draw.rect parentheses surface, comma, color, comma, rectangle, comma, border size. Let's fill in all the things we know so far. The surface is the display surface, so we enter screen here. Then the color is dark green and the border size is 5 pixels. Now let's think about the position and the size of the rectangle. For the rectangle, we want the coordinates of its top left corner, its width and its height. Since we want to have a frame of 75 pixels around the game window, the rectangle will be drawn with the following coordinates: offset minus 5, comma, offset minus 5, comma, and the width and the height. Cell size times number of cells plus 10, comma, cell size times number of cells plus 10. We subtract 5 pixels from the x and y coordinates because the rectangle has a 5 pixel border. That's why we add 10 pixels to the width and the height of it as well. So to draw the dark green rectangle, the code looks like this. Now that we have added the frame, let's see how the game looks. Unfortunately, the positions of the snake and the foot are not calculated correctly due to the omission of the offset. Let's fix it now. We need to make changes to the draw methods in both the snake and foot classes. In the snake class, we simply add offset to the x and y coordinates of the rectangle that we are drawing on the screen. So we type offset plus here and here. We do the same in the foot class in the draw method in the foot rectangle. Offset plus here and here. We are just adding offset to its x and y coordinates. Let's try the game again. Excellent! Everything is working as intended. Now let's give the game a title, add a score and sounds, and we are done. In Pygame, to create and display some text, we need to follow 3 steps. First, we need to create a font, then a surface with the text we want to display, and then we can display that surface using the blit method of the display surface object. First, let's draw the game title. So, outside of the game loop, below the pygame.init call, let's create a font and call it titleFont. TitleFont is equal to pygame.font.font with a capital F, and we have to give it a font family and a size. For the font family, I will enter none, so it will use the default font of the pygame module. For the size of the font, I give it the value of 60. The first step is done. Now we have to create a surface for the title inside the game loop in the drawing part of it. To do this, we use the render method from our title font object. Title surface is equal to titleFont.render. We pass in the string that we want to display, retro snake. We set the anti-alias argument to true, and finally we set the color of the font. I am going to set it to dark green. Now we can call the blit method to display the title surface on the display surface, which we have named screen. Blit means block image transfer. Most of the time in Pygame, we are going to be blitting images to the display surface. We have to pass in the surface we want to display and the location on the screen. So we type screen.blit parentheses title surface and the position we want it to be in a tuple. Let's say parentheses offset minus 5, comma 20. That's it. If we run the game now, we can see that the game title appears. Very cool. Let's now add a score to our game. First, we need to add a score attribute to the game class. So, in the init method of the game class, we add self.score equals 0. The score will be increased by 1 every time the snake eats a food object. Let's go to the collision with food method. Here we have to increase the score by 1. Self.score plus equals 1. The last thing we have to do is to reset the score to 0 every time the game ends. So inside the game over method, we set the score to 0. Self.score equals 0. Now that we have implemented the scorekeeping feature, let's display the score on the screen. Again, we are going to follow the three steps required to display a text on the screen. First, we are going to create a new font object for the score. Score font is equal to pygame.font.font, parentheses, none, comma, 40. Now, in the game loop, we need to create a surface for the score text. Score surface is equal to scorefont.render, parentheses, str, parentheses, game.score, comma, true, comma, dark green. Here we convert the game score to a string because it is a number. Now all we have to do is to bleat the score surface, so we type screen.bleat, parentheses, score surface, comma, parentheses, and now we have to enter a position here. For x we enter offset minus 5, and for y offset plus cell size times number of cells plus 10. If we run the game now, we are going to see the score displayed on the screen. Every time the snake eats some food, the score increases, and every time the game ends, the score resets to 0. Now, let's implement the final step of the project. Let's add sounds to the game. I have created a new folder named Sounds in my game folder, and in it, I have placed two sound files, one named it.mp3 and the other one named wall.mp3. We want to play a sound every time the snake eats the food and every time it hits the wall. In Pygame, loading and playing a sound file is very easy. First, we have to load the two sound files. So we go to the snake class and we are going to load them in the init method. We are going to create two new attributes for the two sounds. Self.eatSound is equal. Now we need to load the first sound file, pygame.mixer.sound, with a capital S, and inside the parentheses we need to pass the file like this, quotes sounds slash it.mp3. We do the same for the second sound as well. Self.wallHitSound is equal to pygame.mixer.sound, parentheses, quotes sounds slash wall.mp3. We have loaded the sound files. Now, to play the sounds, we just have to call the play method of the sound class. So, in our game class, we have to go to the check collision with food method and add the following line, self.snake.eatSound.play. And in the game over method, we have to add this line of code, self.snake.wallHitSound.play. And with that, our game is complete. Let's test it out. Perfect, the game works, and we can hear the sounds when the snake eats the food or hits the wall. Congratulations on reaching this far in the tutorial. It is great to see you taking the time to learn and improve your skills in game development. Your dedication is paying off, and you are one step closer to creating your own amazing games. To further your knowledge and continue learning, be sure to subscribe to our channel for more tutorials like this one. We will keep you updated with new and exciting projects that can work on to enhance your skills. Thank you very much for watching this video. I'll see you next time.